everyone, and welcome to the 20th annual James D. Ployhar Honor Band. My name is Tara Dahl, and it is my great pleasure to introduce our first performing group of the evening, the VCSU Concert Band. Members of the band hail from 31 communities across the Northern Plains, ranging from Circle, Montana in the west to Twin Valley, Minnesota in the east, as far north as Walhalla, and as far south as Sioux Falls, South Dakota. The ensemble gives multiple annual performances on campus and is currently planning for a tour of eastern North Dakota in the coming spring semester. Tonight, we are excited to share with you a piece entitled Symphonic Dance No. 3, Fiesta. Composed in 1964 by Clifton Williams, Fiesta is the third song in a series of five symphonic dances. Each of the five dances represents a different time and place in the history of San Antonio, Texas. Fiesta reflects the excitement and color of the city's many Mexican celebrations, which Williams called the pageantry of Latin American celebration. Street bands, bullfights, bright costumes, and the colorful legacy of a proud people. Without further ado, would you please give a warm welcome to the VCSU Concert Band under the direction of Professor Gerald Heide.
Thank you. you very much, folks. We'll have just a few moments as we add some chairs for the honor band and get the other band transitioned to stage. So we appreciate your patience as we make the switch. in, folks. I am pleased, as the director of the festival, to introduce the 20th annual James D. Ployhar Honor Band. This is our second that we have had here in the beautiful Center for the Arts, and I'd like to give you just a little bit of information on putting this band together and recognize those folks that helped make this event possible over the last 2 days. So what you see before you is the result of 78 accepted auditions from 20 different schools. This shows an incredible amount of continued support from directors, students, and parents alike. So I would like to recognize those directors who put in the hard work of helping prepare these students for this. So directors that are in the audience, would you please stand and be recognized at this time? And would you please give them a round of applause? It does take a village to run this event here at VCSU, and it wouldn't be possible without the support of some fabulous staff and faculty that we have here. Specifically, I'd like to mention the CFA staff and the faculty here in our building, the VCSU music students for their gracious help throughout the event, Sherry Linneruth with Eckroth Music for the booth that she provided today, Sodexo and dining services in the student center, the VCSU business office for running our check-in table, the tech services for running our live stream here tonight, and enrollment services for providing information for the students on the first day. Could I please get a hand for all of these folks? And then we reverse the role for a moment. It also wouldn't be possible without the support staff. This would be the chaperones, the bus drivers, the folks that help to get people here and keep them taken care of, as well as the administration of the school for overseeing it, and the parents, grandparents, and relatives for showing up in support of your students at this event. Most of you fought through bad roads to get here, and yet here you are. So if you came to support a student as a parent, admin, or support staff from your school, would you please stand, and students on stage, give them a round of applause. I know, parents, I put you on the spot to stand up. I probably would have resisted that as well. Yes. So I will keep it as brief as I can. We would like to honor some multi-year participants for the event as well. So we have a plethora of second-year participants. As I call your name, students, please rise and remain standing until all names in your category have been called. Second-year participants: August Harms, Beatrix Homsel, Clara Harms, Danica Freeberg, Elena Meyer, Elena Baim, Emma Klein, Evie Geiger, Gu Bu, Jackson Freeberg, Jordan Jensen, Cami Leadham, Kyron Brajos, Leah Meyer, Lucas Selsler, Nora Ingram, Vincent Strenge, Zach Hammer, and Rika Edwardson. Would you please give these students a round of applause? And we are fortunate to have three third-year participants as well. Typically, these students are the juniors and seniors. Although eighth graders are eligible, we do anticipate down the road here with who we've had that it is possible eventually to have a fifth-year participant. In the meantime, our third-year participants are Emma Briggs on clarinet, Joseph Gord on euphonium, and Kyrell Jacobson playing tuba. Congratulations, folks. With very little more ado, I would like to introduce our guest clinician. So our guest clinician for tonight is Ms. Melinda Halverson, formerly of Bismarck High and currently teaching at Bismarck Horizon Middle School. She is an educator with a wealth of experience across the United States between North Dakota, Ohio, and South Dakota. She has been a wonderful colleague to work with for the last 2 days, and she's a really nice person and a good friend. So would you please give a warm welcome to the stage and her first honor band conducting gig, Ms. Melinda Halverson. As the students can set for the next song, I'll give you a little bit of a background about Niobrara River sketches. So if you're not familiar with the Niobrara River, it flows 568 miles from its headwaters in Wyoming all the way across the state of Nebraska, where it merges in confluence with the Missouri River about 40 miles, I would say, upstream from Lewis and Clark Lake. So it's a peaceful river, starts with streams. It's known for being very wide and very broad and not very deep, as most rivers are in that neck of the woods. But the Niobrara is special. It is a scenic river in Nebraska. It was designated so in 1991. So it has become a recreational river for the most part, is what it's known as now. So the Nebraska State Bandmasters Association decided to commission a piece in 2003. They got it done in 2005. They hired Larry McTaggart, who was at the time was the arranger for the Heartland of America Band, which is the primary military band out of Omaha at the base. So he came up with this piece in three sections. The first section is entitled Tubing on the River, which is by far the most popular activity that happens on the Niobrara. The second part is Sunset in Cherry County, which is the largest county in the state, and it has the beautiful sand hills in it. And the third closing section is the hoedown from Niobrara. So we hope you enjoy the three sections of Niobrara River Sketches.
Thank you.
This event was begun 20 years ago in the namesake of James D. Ployhar, who was an absolute legend in the band world, and we owe much of what we have here at Valley City State to his legacy. So at this point, I would like to invite his daughter, Carol Hoagland, to come to the stage and share a few words about her father. Carol, would you please join us? Could you give her a hand?
Talent, and thank you to all who brought them here, who encouraged them to come. Thank you to you guys for taking time and driving on icy roads to get here and play. I'm not sure that I've ever heard a nation's prayer played as well as I heard it here tonight, and that's true. Thank you to Professor Heidi and Ms. Halverson for being the guest clinician and for arranging this whole program and participating. As he said, I'm the daughter of James Ployhar. I'm the second oldest of their five children. And I'm the only one that lives in the area, therefore it falls upon me to come and talk to you. But it's really never a problem because I love to talk about my dad and I love to hear the musicians, and it's just a joy for me to do that. And I bring you greetings from the rest of my siblings who live far away. So I'm just gonna say a few words, but I tend to babble on, so I'll try and cut it short. I was gonna tell you one of my remembrances from childhood, and I remember things, but this is so emblazoned into my memory. I was laying there in bed, trying to go to sleep as a little bitty girl. I was about four. And I could hear in the basement, I could hear this, thump, 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 thump. And I knew what it was, and it kind of lulled me to sleep. But I didn't realize at that moment what a kind of a turning point in our family's life that was. And I'm going to back up, and then I'll go back to that. I'm going to back up and tell you where we got to that point. Dad was born and raised here in Valley City, and he always liked music. You know, music was kind of easy for him. He loved it, and he formed a band in high school, and they played, and he arranged the music for them to play, and, you know, they played for dances. Well, he got enlisted in the Army right after high school, and he was sent to the Philippines, and on the Philippines trip over in the troop ship, he formed a band, and they played for the troops on the ship. So it was still with him. He still carried his music with him. He managed to get through the war without being hurt and came back to Valley City State University to go to school. He had to pick a major. Well, you'd think it was a big plan, but no, it was never a big plan. He just liked music and thought, well, I guess I'll go into music education. So he did, and he taught a couple years and got married, started his family, and came back to Greeley, Colorado to get his master's. And at that point, something else very important happened in his life. He took a class in composing, and it turned out he did a pretty good job, he thought, but he was afraid to show the director of the band what he had done, his professor. And finally, after a couple days of carrying it around with him, gotta give him this, I gotta show him what I've done. So he did, and the director loved it, and the band loved to play it. So they took it on their tour that year, their spring concert tour, and they said, you really ought to publish this, you know, you really ought to, this is pretty good. Oh, well, no. Well, he sent it off, and it got rejected two or three times, never give up. About the third time, a publisher in Minneapolis decided, well, yeah, this is great. It sold really well. It was performed many, many times, so he kind of got the bug. Well, he graduated, and he had a chance to go to Nebraska to teach, and at the last minute, Fargo called and said, we need an instructor at our middle school. Would you like to come here? For some reason, he thought, okay, North Dakota's better than Nebraska. Well, he was born here, so. Anyway, he came here, and he met a really good friend that was an orchestra director, and they became very close, and they cooked up this idea that, you know, there isn't a lot of music for young kids learning to play that sounds good, but they can play. You know how young kids starting out have a little trouble. Well, his partner said, yeah, we should do that. We should publish music. Well, he had a little success publishing that first number. So they said, well, let's just not send it off. Let's do it ourselves. So they rented or bought an old printing press, put it in the basement of our house. I'm sleeping way upstairs with my two siblings, and every night, kerthump, 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 they would print music in the basement. Well, it went on from there, and he made other good life choices, and finally, about 19 years after he started teaching, he decided he either had to become a music writer and full-time publisher and clinician, or he had to stay with teaching. He couldn't do both. And it was a really hard decision, but he decided, well, I can do both. I can't teach, but I can teach at clinics like Ms. Halverson is doing with you. I could come and guest conduct and teach, so that's what he did the rest of his career. He wrote music from home in his basement, a new house, but a basement. And basements were his thing, I guess. And that's where he went after 800 and some publications later before he passed away in 2007. So little moments here and there throughout life were turning points, but at the time we didn't recognize it, but oftentimes looking back you do. The printing press in the basement and the putting teaching to become a full-time clinician was the best choice for him, and it turned out really well for us too. So now you know a little bit about my dad. The concert's named after him, which we're very honored about. And I will quit now and let you hear the rest of their beautiful music. Thanks, guys.
Well, to conclude a wonderful 2 days, I would like to present our guest clinician with a certificate commemorating her time here with us. So this says, congratulations, Ms. Melinda Halverson, on conducting the James D. Ployhar Honor Band given the 27th day of October, 2023. Thank you and congratulations.
Before we conclude today's concert, I just wanted to say a few words and a huge thank you. This has been amazing, a day and a half. These kids are amazing. I feel like I'm getting all the credit, but they have worked so hard and they have done so much in a day and a half. Even from day one, both Mr. Heidi and I were like, these guys sound like they've been playing together for 5 years already. And a couple of them have been playing together for a few years, but it's just incredible. And they just have been working so hard. They put in so much time. Over the last 2 days, they've had about 8 hours of rehearsals. So just constant playing pretty much for 8 hours. And it's just incredible what they've accomplished. I have a few thank yous to make. Thank you to Valley City State and for Mr. Heidi for inviting me here. Again, this has been an awesome experience and just very cool. He said at the beginning, this is my first time doing something like this, and I'm so grateful to be able to. I have to thank my own school, Horizon Middle School, for allowing me to come here, for my colleagues picking up and getting subs and all that good stuff. So I appreciate them a lot. And to my own family, for my husband is doing double duty tonight. He had to take my kids to a dance, and he had to take my kids to school, and all these things. So I super appreciate all the people in my life that just kind of pick up the slack when I get to do things like this. And a huge thank you again to our students, to you as parents and teachers for all you're doing for music education. And a lot of these kids are looking at continuing on, which is just awesome to see, because I'm gonna tell you, we need music educators out there more than ever. We need to continue this, because without music educators, this goes away and this experience starts to go away. So as much of you as we hope that they go into music ed, and we hope that they can continue their passion through others. It is an awesome experience. So a huge hand to you guys and to these students. We're gonna conclude tonight's concert with kind of a little bit out there piece. This piece is called The Great Steamboat Race. And it's what you think it is. It's a steamboat race, and it's depicted through the music that it has. So Robert W. Smith was the person who wrote this piece. He's the composer, and unfortunately passed away just a couple months ago. He is known for many, many compositions that are very similar, just very different, not typical, and have a lot of just great ideas within them. He uses a lot of great ideas for percussion. So in this piece, you're gonna hear some water jugs that is gonna symbolize the churning of the steamboats as they go. This piece represents something that happened in 1870. They actually had steamboat races, and this one specifically was a famous one. I can't imagine, like, this was probably their pastime and entertainment. And so it took 3 days and 21 hours to complete this mission, and it was super competitive. Like, one of the guys is like throwing stuff off his boat, trying to make it lighter so he could win the race. And so you're gonna kind of hear that throughout, and it goes down the Mississippi. So if you've ever been to the Mississippi, you can kind of envision how that's gonna look, kind of by New Orleans. So you're gonna hear some of that jazzy rhythm and jazzy kind of sounds that kind of represent that New Orleans area, as well as kind of that steamboat sound. You're gonna hear a lot of that in our flutes. And then they all of a sudden run into some fog, and you're gonna hear like this just mysterious kind of area. And they come out, there was two ships. One of them was the Robert E. Lee, and one of them was the Natchez. In the end, Robert E. Lee won it. So if you want more history on that, I can tell you later. But for right now, we're gonna finish out tonight's concert with The Great Steamboat Race. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
year. Please travel safe on your way home.